Okay, so Jupiter's Legacy Season 1 is now out on Netflix, and the show ends with a big cliffhanger that teases towards some major events coming down the line. Chances are you have a lot of questions about what's going to happen next, and there are some big twists and reveals in the work that make it an incredible read. The comic storyline is outstanding, and in this video we're going to be breaking down both the plotline of Jupiter's Legacy and its prequel comic, Jupiter's Circle. Full spoilers ahead, so if you don't want anything ruined, then I recommend that you turn off now. Also, please click the thumbs up button and make sure you subscribe to the channel for breakdowns like this each and every day. With that out of the way, thank you for clicking this, now let's get into Jupiter's Legacy. Okay, so like the series, the comic centers around Sheldon Sampson, a businessman who lost almost everything during the Wall Street crash of 1929. The Great Depression was worse than a James Charles apology video, and it affected a lot of people. Sheldon was left with absolutely no money, and thus he decided that things had to change. Driven by a desire to make America the greatest country in the world, the character was haunted by dreams that told him to venture to a mysterious island off the coast of Cape Verde. With his friends and family, Sheldon chartered a boat there, and they were amazed to find that it was exactly as he had described it. As they scaled its treacherous terrain, they slowly realized that it wasn't actually an island, and instead was a giant spacecraft. Upon discovering a doorway on it, the group ventured inside, and it's here they came across some aliens who blessed them with incredible abilities. These were the world's first superheroes, and Jupiter's Circle tells of their journey through the rest of the 20th century. The group formed a superhero team known as the Union, and they fought crime throughout America. Sampson imparted on them a code of ethics that stated they would never take a life, nor get involved in politics, but they found that increasingly difficult as time went on. Just stay off Twitter, yeah, you'll be absolutely fine. Now, early on in Jupiter's Circle, it's revealed that Blue Bolt is actually gay, and the FBI take photos of him one night that they attempt to use as blackmail. J. Edgar Hoover leads up this front, and he threatens to release the images to the public if Blue Bolt doesn't divulge the world's biggest unanswered questions, such as the team's true identities, what happens when we die, and of course, who let the dogs out. Blue Bolt tries to end his own life, but he survives, and tells the Union of this, who realize that the FBI are trying to close in on them. Shortly after, Sky Fox discovers that Hoover himself is gay, and blackmails him too with similar images so that he won't go public. Now, slotted throughout this story is the tale of Flair, or rather Fitz, a superhero that starts an affair with a 19-year-old called April. Fitz hides the Flair affair from his wife, and attempts to get April into the Union, even though she doesn't have any superpowers. Before he can say, "I can make you a celebrity overnight," the Union tell him that he has to stop seeing her, and though he initially does this, he ends up having a change of heart and later divorces his wife and proposes to April. The Flair's son is furious over this and says that he will get what's coming to him, and it's not too long before this rings true. During a battle, the Flair is left paralyzed and April ends up leaving him. However, his wife Joyce comes back, and we also see that his son is starting to develop superpowers. Next, the focus moves to Sky Fox, who we follow as he journeys on a downward spiral that gets worse and worse than the jokes in this video. Sky Fox, or rather George, starts dating a girl named Sunny, and the pair fall in love. However, his alcoholism, arrogance, and immaturity drive a wedge between the pair, and when he proposes, she refuses to be his wife. Terrible. Now, he tries whatever he can to get her, but she starts dating Walter, and when George discovers this, he's extremely angry. George believes that Walter has used his psychic abilities to make her fall in love with him, but he flat out denies it. George ends up leaving the Union over this, and he starts to live in Kentucky, where he flies under the radar. He was pretty important to the Union though, and we discover that he actually designed the Supermax prison, which becomes a key location later on. The next character which takes focus is Sheldon, aka the Utopian. Primarily, we see things through the eyes of his wife, who believes she's living the perfect life because of everything that Sheldon does for her. Across the country, we see as things fall into civil unrest and watch the riots of 1965 play out. Sampson says that the Union aren't going to get involved in this because they want to remain apolitical. George, however, ends up attending them, But much to the surprise of the police, he's on the side of the black citizens. George realizes that staying out of politics is nearly impossible, and if he were alive in our world, it's at this point that he would probably run for the governor of California. I mean, every idiot's doing it. Now, George believes that they were given the powers not to just keep things as the status quo, but rather to change the world for the better. He becomes a supervillain and even holds the vice president hostage, saying that he won't let him go until the Vietnam War is ended. Now, it's during this time that the supervillain Hobbs enacts his plan to take down the Union. After creating a weapon that renders them without their powers, he throws them into a black matter doorway. Just before they die, George arrives and saves the day, and he's accepted back into the group. However, tensions with Walt rise once more, and Walt actually admits that he did make Sonny fall in love with him. This sends George over the edge, more than finding out that U2 have added their album to your iPhone without you asking, and the pair end up in a fight. The Utopian stops George from killing his brother, and even though Sky Fox tells him that Walter did mind control Sonny, it falls on deaf ears. Sheldon suspects that Walter might be lying when he says that he didn't, but George takes the fall and he's put in the Supermax. However, as he helped to build it, he's able to escape and he goes incognito once more. Now, during all of this, Rockefeller goes to Sheldon with a proposition. He says that if he becomes the father of his child, that he'll donate half of his money to a charity of his choosing. Sheldon refuses this indecent proposal, but the idea sits with him for quite a while. After building a friendship with Hobbs in prison, the pair decide to work together in order to help the world. Sheldon gives away his money to charity and gets a job, which makes his wife Jane divorce him as she realizes he's too perfect. She wants a man with flaws, namely me, and thus leaves him, which allows Sheldon to hook up with Grace. The pair have two children called Brandon and Chloe, and this takes us into Jupiter's Legacy. Now, Legacy opens in the 21st century, namely 2013. The world is still trying to bounce back from the recession, and due to the Union taking out most of the villains, there's no one to fight. Because of this, the offspring of the group are pretty much bored all the time, and Brandon spends most of his nights in clubs, whilst Chloe is a drug addict. Brandon is about as useful as a YouTuber, and scorned by constantly feeling like he's not good enough, he tries to ferry a ship across the sky. However, he almost drops it, and his dad has to swoop in to save the day. Now, elsewhere, Walter has slowly started to realize that George was right. He's come to the conclusion that if they stay out of politics, the world will get worse and worse because humans can't be trusted to not vote for people like Count Binface, who, by the way, would have got my vote for a third time. Now, if you're American and watching this and don't know who Count Binface is, basically, there's a guy called Count Binface who has a bin for a face, and he ran for mayor, and he actually got more votes than most of the other candidates. Anyway, Walter realizes that the world requires new leadership, and that the Utopian is standing in the way of this. It is possible that, because of his knowledge, he could have saved the family way back in 29, and he won't let his brother stand in his way again. Thus, he enacts a plan to overthrow him, but he knows he's not powerful enough to do it by himself. Instead, Walter goes to Brandon and convinces him that it's time to step out of his father's shadow and take control. Elsewhere, we learn that Chloe has been meeting up with the son of Sky Fox, who is called Hutch. Hutch was born without powers, but his dad felt bad and made him a power rod out of a flashlight. This responds to his voice and has the ability to teleport anywhere he chooses. Chloe discovers that she's pregnant with his child and goes to her mother. It's at this point that Walter launches his attack, and he goes to Grace and kills her. Walter traps her in what he calls a psychic painting, whilst other members of his team wail on her in reality, and he then goes to kill Chloe. However, Hutch arrives and warps her out of there, but the ambush still continues. The Utopian flies into space, believing there is an attack, and at this point, Walter and Brandon launch their forces. They kick the crap out of the Utopian, and then Brandon kills his father. Brandon believes that he has taken charge, but it's very clear that it's actually Walter who will be making the decisions, as Brandon is well out of his depth. This takes us to the second arc in the volume, which has a big time jump. Chloe is clean, and she's now living in Australia with her husband Hutch and their son Jason. After the death of the Utopian, those who didn't join Brandon's side were classed as supervillains, and they have been hunted across the globe by Barnabas Wolfe. Jason has inherited superpowers from his parents, but not wanting to draw suspicion, he dons a disguise and goes out and does good deeds. He also performs averagely in school, namely sports and exams, but retreats to the moon once in a while to try and reach out to the so-called supervillains. In Washington, we realise that Brannon surprisingly wasn't a very good leader, and a lot of people protest him. He shouts them down using his power, but clearly his choices have been very unpopular. Barnabas, hunting for Jason, discovers that, though he hid his tracks well, is visible in the reflection of a single raindrop, and thus he fakes a bridge collapse so that the character will swoop in to save the day. Wolf springs his trap and almost kills the boy, but his mother and father come to the rescue. Now this is where we get to the second volume, and early on it focuses very much on pulling the supervillains together as a team to bring Bran and Walter down. They recruit several of them hidden across the globe, and then go to rescue a parasitic one named Repro. Guarded by Walter's daughter Raiku, several of the Supes stall her and take her across the country because she's able to read minds and they don't want her to become aware of the plan before it's too late. Now, the group manage to free Repro and he mimics Raiku's powers, trapping her in a psychic painting, much like her father did to his enemies. Across the planet, Brannon holds a presentation that is meant to showcase his government's powers, but an insurgent attacks it and detonates a nuke which kills everyone there other than the Supes. This sends Brannon into a rage and he decides to invade China against Walter's wishes. He's truly lost it at this point and the supervillains decide to turn to help from someone long forgotten. That is Sky Fox. Chloe, Hutch and Jason go to visit him to find him living on his own in a pretty rundown building. Initially, he doesn't want to be part of their plan, but he does take a shine to Jason. He tells him he finds him very interesting and wonders how that happened as he hates kids. Jason says that it's because his dad didn't leave him, and though he kicks them out first, it guilt trips Sky Fox into joining their side. He sees this as the final chance to kick Walter's ass, and they launch their attack. Now, the battle is absolutely brilliant, and as has become a staple of the series, there's a lot of kicking involved, kicking people's heads in. Now, Sky Fox initially gets the upper hand on Walter, but he sets the character alight and kills him in the process. Hutch goes to attack him, but Walter causes a plane to crash, and being a good guy, Hutch travels to that instead to rescue everyone on board. Meanwhile, Brannon and Chloe go head to head in a brother versus sister battle that sees her very much demonstrating how she's far more powerful than he is. Repro arrives, and against Walter, they go into a psychic battle. No, not like the one in South Park. Now, this is one of the best bits in the book, and the pair constantly try and convince each other that the reality they created is what's really going on. There's a brilliant scene in which Walter acts like Repro has been in a coma this entire time, and the whole thing involving superheroes was just a dream. The first time I read it, yeah, I'm not gonna lie, it did trick me. Now, the pair have an incredible battle, but ultimately, Walter distracts him long enough to throw a car at him. Brannon summons a tsunami, which Chloe destroys with her voice, which you may have seen her demonstrating at the start of episode 1. With Repro out the way, Walter goes to finish Hutch. Not like that, you dirty bad boy. And with Hutch having no powers, Walter just toys with him. He duplicates several versions of himself that walk towards him very slowly and says he'll give him a free shot to see if he can guess the real one. Hutch utters the words, "Real Walter's head," and the power rod goes straight to its target. It's one of my favourite comic book moments of all time, and I absolutely love watching it play out every time I read it. I'm kinda gutted they did something similar in season 1, as it was such a big surprise in the book, but either way, this still stands strong as an amazing moment. Walter is dead, and his son arrives to kill Hutch, but out of nowhere, Jason shows up with all the other supervillains that he's rescued from the Supermax. Brannon admits defeat, and says, "I guess we're done here," but Chloe has one last thing that she wants to do. With the power rod, she teleports herself and Brannon to Mars, and you guessed it, kicks the crap out of him. Go on, get him. Go on, get him. Now, Brannon is placed in the Supermax, Hutch becomes the new Sky Fox, Jason the new Utopian, and Chloe the new Lady Liberty. She apologizes to the public for letting them all down and says it won't happen again. We end with the three sat in a diner enjoying life, feeling fulfilled in finally having found a purpose. And that's the story of Jupiter's Legacy. Now, obviously, I'd love to hear your thoughts on it and what you want to see in season 2. Make sure you comment below and let me know. And as a thank you for interacting with the video, you'll be entered into a prize draw on the 30th of May, in which we're giving away 3 copies of the Godzilla vs. Kong Legacy Collection. All you have to do to be on the chance of winning is like the video, make sure you subscribe with notifications on, and drop a comment below with your thoughts on the series. The winners of last month's competition are on screen right now, so if that's you, then message me on Twitter at Heavy Spoilers. Now if you want something else to watch, we've just done a big ending explained on the season, so any questions you have will be covered in that. It's linked on screen right now, go on, click it, you know you want to. If you're hearing this, I know you haven't clicked it yet, but you're probably off to go do something better, so thanks for sticking with me through this. I'll see you next time. Take care, I love you.